The world's seven largest polluters generate more than half of all greenhouse gases. These emissions have made our planet 1 degree Celsius hotter, on average, than it was at the start of the Industrial Revolution 150 years ago. It can be complicated to weigh the warming effects of these different chemicals, which vary substantially in their potency compared to CO2 and in their prevalence in the atmosphere. To solve this, scientists cleverly devised a universal unit of measurement that quantifies the total impact of any greenhouse gas in terms of its carbon dioxide equivalent, CO2e. This is 1 metric ton of CO2e. 1 million metric tons is called a megaton, and 1 billion tons is a gigaton. Human activity now produces over 50 gigatons of CO2e a year. But to understand exactly where these emissions come from, we can sort them by the economic sector that produced them. As you can see, the electricity and heating sector produces by far the most CO2e, responsible for 30% of all emissions. What's far more interesting is to drill down to the countries emitting the most within each sector, geographical categorizations I call geosectors. The top 10 emitting geosectors are distributed across 5 countries, with half in China alone. China creates the most agriculture emissions in the world. Overall, agriculture emissions account for 11% of all CO2e globally, with China's farmers and ranchers accounting for 13% of this sector. These emissions have hardly increased, though, over the last 20 years, and its population growth rate has slowed down. It is now only 1/5 of what it was in the early 1970s. These are positive signs, but there could be trouble on the horizon. Because of how carbon-intensive meat production is, it is vital that the Chinese limit consumption of beef and pork as protein sources. This will show up in the emissions per capita data. If this number starts to climb, we are all in trouble, as it is multiplied by 1.4 billion souls. Over the last 30 years, as incomes have risen in China, so has meat consumption, nearly tripling to 60 kilograms per person per year. Making matters worse, the rising global demand for beef is being met by Brazil, which has been rapidly deforesting the carbon-rich Amazon rainforest to make room for cattle ranches. But there's also reason to be optimistic. Meat substitutes that look and taste just like the real thing will inevitably spread from America to the grocery stores and restaurants of China. And with more countries moving to tax the sources of CO2e emissions, the price of beef and pork seems likely to rise to reflect the damage big livestock does to our environment. Russia's electricity and heating sector is the world's 9th largest source of emissions, although it's far less than 1.3 gigatons it was in the early 90s. This is mainly due to its strategic embrace over the last 30 years of methane, also known as natural gas, which burns cleaner than coal and is more profitable to extract and export. But there are hidden dangers to Russia's embrace of methane natural gas. As I outlined in the fugitive emissions geosector, far too much of the methane produced by Russia leaks, and a molecule of methane warms the planet much more than a molecule of carbon dioxide. The other danger is how disproportionately reliant the Russian economy is on its energy sector compared to other countries of similar size. It doesn't have to be this way. Moscow could be using the profits from its lucrative energy sector to better position itself for the future by developing its vast renewable energy resources. Russia should be a clean energy superpower. It has the world's largest potential energy generation from both hydro and wind power. For example, its technical potential of wind energy, the amount reasonably capturable using the latest equipment, is 50,000 terawatt hours per year. That staggering figure is more than 25 times the electricity the entire Russian Federation is projected to consume 10 years from now, in 2030. Of course, the reason Russia isn't racing to become a clean energy superpower is its current leadership only cares about maintaining the status quo so they can continue to enrich themselves. President Vladimir Putin and his associates have pocketed hundreds of billions of dollars from Russian companies, mainly in the energy sector, squirreling these vast fortunes away in hidden offshore bank accounts and foreign real estate holdings. Highlighting the absurdity of his pro-fossil fuel stance, last year President Putin questioned wind power by saying, "The movement of turbines causes worms to come out of the soil." He also expressed concern for the damage being done to local birds. Now, if that sounds familiar, it's because President Trump said just about the same thing 5 months later. With an economy crippled by corruption and disproportionately reliant on fossil fuels, how quickly the Russian people can modernize their country will be a major factor in determining the fate of the planet. China's transportation sector is the eighth largest emitter of CO2e gases. It would be much more were it not for the rise of affordable electric vehicles and cheap batteries, which have saved hundreds of megatons of pollution already. Beijing has made historic investments in electrified transit, with electric cars, e-bikes, 500,000 e-buses, and a high-speed rail network that now reaches 80% of big cities, collectively replacing what would have been tens of billions of oil-fueled passenger trips. With the electrification of its domestic transportation sector well underway, China's companies are in position to dominate the global electric vehicle and battery markets for decades. As we will see in the upcoming episode on transportation sector solutions, China-made e-buses are already on the streets of California. The latest models are even capable of rapid wireless charging.
So when the bus pulls into the transit center for its normal 10-minute layover while customers get on and off, it's actually picking up a brief charge too. And by doing that 7 or 8 times a day, we add 100, 120 miles of range.
One of the sectors with the fastest rising emissions is electricity generation in India. With a massive, young population primed to achieve better living standards over the next 2 decades, India's ability to deploy renewable energy and efficient appliances at scale will go a long way toward determining whether we can hold warming below 1.5 degrees C. As we will see throughout this series, there are reasons to be hopeful about India. Exemplifying how simple individual actions can make a huge collective impact is India's embrace of energy-efficient LED light bulbs. These became wildly popular just as hundreds of millions of Indians gained access to electricity for the first time. The scale of saving tens of billions of watts of electricity every day has prevented arguably more emissions than any other solution anywhere in the world. China's extremely prolific infrastructure build-out over the last 15 years has used a prodigious amount of cement, the glue material in concrete, the world's primary construction material. Cement production is extremely energy-intensive and is the dominant emission source in the industrial processes sector, which now sends over 1.1 billion tons of CO2e per year into the atmosphere, 11 times what it generated at the dawn of its economic boom 30 years ago. With large parts of Southeast Asia and Africa looking to emulate the Chinese growth model, it is vital that we develop a lower emission method of producing concrete. An even better solution would be to engineer super strong sustainable materials that can replace concrete completely, something we will explore in detail in future episodes. The thriving petrochemical and pharmaceutical industries also require innovations to make their production more sustainable. The fifth largest source of emissions is from land use changes in Indonesia. The coastal lowlands of Southeast Asia hosts one-third of all tropical peatlands, but since the 1980s, this ecosystem in Indonesia has suffered extensive losses. To make room for palm and pulpwood plantations, farmers set fires to thick mangrove wetlands or lowered the groundwater level to expose root zones, drying plants out and killing them.
Peatlands in their natural state are covered in lush tropical forest. They're bogs. They are essentially waterlogged all year round. But when you drain them, when you remove the forest, the peat itself, the soil, become exposed to sunlight and it dries out because of the drainage. And that's what burns.
This practice is now the single largest source of atmospheric methane. This highlights how vital the land use change in forestry sector is in our battle to stop climate change. We can either expand forests and peatlands to sequester carbon, or we can continue to slash and burn them to make products and raise livestock that few of us actually need. Brazil's land use and forestry emissions deserve an honorable mention here. They will almost certainly climb back into the top 20 sources when the data come in for the last 2 years. Since President Bolsonaro took office there, he has empowered ranchers and loggers to ramp up destruction of the Amazon rainforest, which they've done with gusto. Transportation in the United States is the fourth most polluting sector. We are addicted to driving here in America, mainly due to our low population density and advanced highway system that makes traveling significant distances by car necessary, easy, and fun. The rise of electric vehicles should, eventually, lead to an annual savings of more than a gigaton of CO2e emissions in the US transport sector alone. In a future video, we'll look at the impressive new electric cars hitting showrooms. Although the toughest segment of the sector to electrify will be the hundreds of thousands of long-haul trucks that continuously move shipping containers full of goods throughout the country. Another tough-to-decarbonize segment is large consumer SUVs and pickup trucks that are the best-selling vehicles in America because of all the stuff they can haul and how cheap fuel is. President Trump's administration has also slowed efforts to make cleaner vehicles by gutting fuel efficiency standards, despite these improvements saving 17 gigatons of CO2 over the past four decades. To decarbonize our economies, we should electrify every process we can. But this electrify everything strategy is predicated on renewably generated electricity overtaking coal, oil, and natural gas. Luckily, this is finally happening in the United States, whose electricity sector is the world's third largest source of emissions. Wind and solar energy is now cost competitive with fossil fuel generated power in a growing majority of states. But there are a lot of existing fossil fueled power plants to replace. Americans are the leading sources of energy pollution, generating 6.6 tons of CO2e per person per year, or more than 2 billion tons in total. The transition in the US and around the world would be turbocharged by building national networks of high voltage transmission lines so that renewable electricity generated in rural areas where land is cheap could be efficiently transmitted to our cities. An unlikely leader has emerged on this front, oil and gas rich Texas. They've invested billions of dollars to connect their windy, sun-drenched west to the heavily populated Dallas-Houston-San Antonio triangle in the east. This network of high-voltage power lines has transformed the Lone Star State into one of America's clean energy leaders, presenting a persuasive case for the rest of the country to follow. It can be easy to forget that the US has spent $3 trillion mired in the oil-rich Middle East since 2003. Imagine if those resources had been spent building the clean energy economy of the future instead. Over the last 30 years, China's strategy to become the world's manufacturing superpower has resulted in a fourfold increase in these emissions. Manufacturing is one of the most difficult areas of the global economy to decarbonize. Just think of all the energy and material to operate all the machinery, factories, and equipment used to make all of our things. All of the containers and warehouses to store all of these objects, and all of the buildings where they are kept alongside us as we live. It is the roads and bridges and sidewalks and runways and light poles and internet cables, the foundation of our hyper-connected two-day shipping paradise. Elements of most of these things are now partially, if not completely, made in China. But now, Beijing is reconfiguring its supply chains to produce more lucrative goods, like vehicles, robots, appliances, and batteries. So China's flattening manufacturing emissions curve is a positive sign, but it's also deceptive. While China is cutting emissions and making its processes more efficient, other countries in Southeast Asia are ramping up manufacturing, happy to fill in the gaps in the production of cheaper goods vacated by the Chinese. This is the difficulty in trying to tackle climate change in the age of globalization. The market will always find the cheapest producer. As wages rise in China, production of lower-end goods shifts to India, Indonesia, and Vietnam. Emissions follow. As the cycle continues, low-wage Africa will be next. But wherever manufacturing takes place, producers must employ the most sustainable processes going forward. An example of how they can do this, as we'll see later in the series, are through innovations in variable speed motors, poised to drive significant energy savings. The largest source of emissions is China's electricity and heating sector. Historically, this energy has been generated by coal, the dirtiest fossil fuel. But lately, China has been using coal-generated electricity to manufacture devices that make electricity from renewable sources. Basically, it has been burning billions of tons of coal, so it will not need to in the future. When a country that big focuses on remaking its entire energy sector, it can do more to fight climate change than anyone else, something I explored a few years ago in my Mega Projects of China series. Even though China is now far and away the world's leading emitter, its per-person emissions have already peaked. This is an extremely promising sign, particularly considering that income and electricity consumption levels continue to rise. This is directly attributable to Beijing's unprecedented investment in zero-emission electricity over the last decade and a half. But there is a long way to go before its energy transition is complete. As its massive infrastructure spending has wound down, China's central government recently loosened restrictions on approving new coal power plants. To boost their economies and create jobs, provincial governments immediately took advantage, leading to around 210 projects, with a total capacity of 169 gigawatts being greenlit in less than a year. But just because there are more coal power plants being built does not guarantee that more coal will be burned. As this chart shows, China continues to add several dozen gigawatts of coal-generated electricity capacity a year, but the average coal power plant there now operates less than half the time, a utilization rate 20% lower than it was just 8 years ago. Coal just can't compete against renewably generated electricity whose kilowatt-hour prices continue to fall. So if coal is losing on price and it's filthy, why are so many provinces still choosing to build them? Why aren't they building photovoltaic, wind turbine, or lithium-ion factories instead? The answer is complicated, but boils down to China's top-down, one-party system that rewards provincial leaders for prioritizing immediate economic growth above other considerations, like the environment. With the engineering know-how, infrastructure, funding, and blueprints for hundreds of coal power projects in place for years, just waiting on approval from Beijing, it's no surprise that so many local party bosses embraced these shovel-ready projects. Still, it is remarkable that a country pursuing renewable energy as aggressively as China is building hundreds of new coal plants. It's an alarming sign of just how hard the fossil fuel industry will fight to stay alive. I hope this episode of the Climate Change Solutions Show clarified where most of our emissions are coming from and where we need to focus our efforts. To recap, the top 10 emitting geosectors are distributed across 5 countries, with half in China alone. For the extended episode profiling the top 20 geosectors, check out my new premium video site, TDC.video. Membership gives you exclusive access to the full version of each episode of the Climate Change Solutions Show. This full episode includes the disturbing effect the 2011 earthquake and tsunami disaster had on Japan's electricity emissions, more on Russia's outsized emissions, and deeper looks at the agriculture geosectors of India, the United States, and Brazil. A premium membership also unlocks all my research links, which are really helpful for efficiently going a lot deeper on your own, while also helping to support this show in these uncertain times. Either way, thanks for watching.